What's up? This is Chris Fitzgerald from Seawolf Studios. Welcome to the webinar. Really excited to have you guys here tonight. We're going to have a lot of fun. We got a lot of stuff to cover, so let's just get right to it. Switch over to the keynote. Okay, great. So, the art of film scoring, how to score a scene, is what is on topic tonight. And I think what we should start with is, in my estimation, the major ingredients to writing film music. The first thing, the most important thing, is that the film is the master. And what I mean by that is whatever music that you write, it has to serve the picture. If the music that you write is not serving the picture, then you're not doing your job as a film composer. So it's one of those industries that you really just have to check your ego at the door and write your music for somebody else's creative project. In addition to that, anywhere there is music, there has to be a reason. And that reason could be that the music is supporting the on-screen action or the unfolding drama. Or perhaps the reason is to manipulate the emotions of the viewer. The reason could potentially be that the director comes to you and says, "I want you to score this scene to cover up some bad acting." I've been delivered that reason before. It's not my favorite reason to score a scene, but it is certainly a reason nonetheless. And as a film composer, you're working for the director, so you gotta listen to them. The film that we're gonna score a scene tonight from this movie, All in the Game, which I had the great pleasure of working on with Mark Marino of White Light Filmworks. And this is a character-driven crime drama shot in a town called Pittsfield, Massachusetts. And we're just watching a short 40-second clip from the movie. So I think I'll just let it speak for itself. And let me just let it roll here.
We've got a visual on a suspect approaching the house.
Okay, we'll give him a minute, then we'll hit it.
Over. Police for the warrant, open up! Take it!
Okay, great. That's the scene we're going to score. Now, before we write a single note, before we even contemplate what we're going to do musically with this scene, there's several important questions that we need to ask. The first is what is happening in terms of action, dialogue. And in this scene, police are staking out this guy's house, and the guy, Callie is the kid's name, he shows up and they move into action and surround his house and knock the door down, and Callie flees out the back door. So, in a nutshell, that's what is happening in the scene. Where is the film set in terms of time and place? Now, if you're Quentin Tarantino, you can get away with having a slavery film set in 1858 and drop a hip-hop piece right in the middle of it. But most of us can't get away with that. So if you're writing music for a period piece, it's a good idea to try to evoke a sense of time and place with your music. Anytime you write music, you have an opportunity to comment on several things. You could use the music to comment on a character, or you could use the music to comment on the era. Time and place for this film, like I was saying earlier, it's shot in a town called Pittsfield, Massachusetts, which doesn't even really enter into the story. So it really could be any town, USA. We know, I mean, we get a sense that it's kind of a crime-ridden neighborhood, and the time is current. So whatever we write for the music has to evoke both of those things, setting the time and place. doesn't have to, but it's going to. Who are the characters? When you're writing music for any film, for any scene, you want to know your characters inside and out. You want to know what their motivations are, what drives them. For this particular scene, the music that we write is really just going to support the on-screen action. So I'm not too worried about character thematic development or anything for this short 40-second clip. That's a topic that we'll definitely get more into in the 6-week Art of Film Scoring class that Seawolf Studios is offering starting next month. I'll tell you guys more about that class near the end of the webinar. We also want to ask, what are the key moments in terms of action elements, character interaction, dialogue lines, camera transitions, all of those things? And to me, there are 3 major action elements in this short scene. And the first one is when the female cop says, give him a minute, then we'll hit it. Because right after she delivers that line, we go from stakeout scene to action scene where they surround the house and go after the guy. The next major action element is right when the cop says police with a warrant open up, right before he bangs down the door. That's the first time in the scene that Callie becomes aware that the police are there. So that's a major action element in the scene. And then the third major action element in this scene is when Callie flees out the back door. So those are kind of the 3 things that we're going to pay attention to in terms of what we want to comment on with our music. Next question, what can and should be emphasized with music? Now, those are 2 totally different questions. What can be emphasized with music is not necessarily what should be emphasized with music, so a very important distinction. Now, as you guys were watching that scene, you might have noticed that it felt kind of dry. I mean, usually when you see a scene like that in a TV show or in a movie, there's some kind of music there to add to the tension. This scene definitely could use some music. We're going to watch it again in just a moment, and I want you guys to pay attention to really just kind of how dry and empty it feels without music there. And then lastly, we want to think about how the music should function. And I've talked about this a little bit already, but what we're going to do with the music for this scene is have it comment on the action, on the unfolding drama, and not necessarily on any specific character. Now, of course, if you're scoring the film, you could have the music commenting on the action of the scene, but kind of weave in one of the themes from a character into the music somehow. So actually, next thing we're going to do is I want to show 2 examples from 2 films where the music functions totally differently. We're going to watch a scene from the movie Crash, which is scored by Mark Isham. And in this scene, Matt Dillon is rescuing this woman from a car crash on the freeway, and the car is about to explode, so it's this really tense scene. I find this scene fascinating because the music is not, it's not commenting on the action. It's really kind of commenting on the overall storylines in the movie. If you haven't seen the movie, it's a great film. And it's kind of commenting on sort of the heroism of the moment. There's a very beautiful vocal melodic thing with this Middle Eastern woman singing this really beautiful kind of mournful melody, and it's in just such stark juxtaposition from what we're seeing on the screen. It's just extremely effective. So anyway, let's watch it. It's about 1.5 minutes long.
Look at me. Everything's going to be fine. We're going to get you out of here. Everything's going to be fine.
Aru is the cool. To the way of my wounded world, a root of goodness.
Okay, pretty intense. So it's interesting because the music is not setting the time and place. I mean, it's this sort of Middle Eastern vocal melody, but that's not at all meant to convey where this scene is unfolding. And the music is not even commenting on the action. I mean, it's really adding a lot of tension and drama, but it's just, it's great. I mean, it really elevates the scene to kind of comment on these larger themes. Again, you kind of have to see the movie to sort of get all that. But anyway, let's move on to the second example, which is a scene from The Matrix, which is a really fun movie. I'm sure most of you guys have seen this. Scored by Don Davis. And in this scene, there's really two different parts to the score in this scene. It transitions partway through. It's pretty obvious where it happens. But in the first one, Neo and Morpheus are starting a fight, and there's kind of this sort of tongue-in-cheek Asian drums kind of kung fu music, and it really adds a little bit of levity to the scene and makes it pretty humorous. And then when the fight really gets underway, it switches to this electronic, really breakbeat drum loop, kind of a electro-driven sort of thing for the rest of the scene. So totally different thing. The music is kind of setting the time and place with the kung fu thing, and then it's also commenting on the unfolding action. So let's watch this scene. It's about a minute and a half as well.
Good. Adaptation, improvisation. But your weakness is not your technique.
Morpheus is fighting Neo.
Okay, totally different type of scene. So two very different uses of music in film. So with that in mind, all those questions that we were just asking, let's apply those to our scene again. So we want to think about what's happening, who the characters are, where's the time and place, really what the music should be commenting on in this scene. And again, I want you to pay attention to a couple things. Just one, pay attention to really how dry this scene is without music. It needs some music there. And secondly, pay attention to those three action elements that I mentioned earlier. After the female police officer says, give him a minute, then we'll hit it. And the second one is right before the, or really right as the cop says, police with a warrant, open up. And then the third, when Callie exits the back door. Those are the three things that we're going to accent with our music.
We've got a visual on a suspect approaching the house.
Okay, we'll give him a minute, then we'll hit it.
Over.
Police for the warrant, open up! Take it!
Okay. So, as film composers, you got to get used to watching a scene over and over and over again. By now, I've probably seen that scene several hundred times, and we're actually going to watch it one more time before we bring it into our music software. So, anyway, before we talk about spotting, I want to call your attention to the time code numbers at the bottom of the video. That is SMPTE time code. SMPTE is S-M-P-T-E. That stands for the Society of Motion Picture and Television Engineers, and they are an organization who came up with this time code system. What time code is an address for every frame of film, and the address is hours, minutes, seconds, frames. And it's a very helpful system. Without time code, your conversations with the director would be more like this. You'd have to say, oh yeah, remember that one scene, like right before the bad guy pulls out the gun and like right as he slams the door, that's when we want the music to start. But now you can just say, let's have the music come in at 1 hour, 1 minute, 37 seconds, 17 frames, boom. So it's very helpful in communicating with all the people that are working on the film. So to understand the frames part of the time code, we need to know what the frame rate of this film is. So I'm actually going to momentarily exit out of Keynote. And let's switch over to, let me open up QuickTime. And I'll bring the movie into QuickTime. Okay, great. QuickTime is the Macintosh video player application. And in QuickTime, there's this inspector window. And that tells me several pieces of very good information. One is FPS right here. FPS is frames per second, which is also known as frame rate. And this film is at 24 frames per second. Now, as a film composer, you'll run into several different frame rates. Some very common ones are 29.97 frames per second, unfortunately, because that's a really obnoxious number to work with, and 23.976 frames per second. So those are both two totally annoying numbers to work with, and they're very close to 30 seconds and 24 seconds, respectively. So there's all sorts of things that they do, like drop frame time code to try to have it like fit a little bit easier into it, you know, a whole number frame. That, again, that's a longer conversation that we can't get into today, but one that we'll explore in depth in this Art of Film Scoring course next month. So anyway, this film is 24 frames per second. And the other thing I want to call your attention to is this number right here, 48,000. 48,000 hertz. That is the digital audio sample rate for the audio in this film. That number is more commonly referred to as 48 kilohertz instead of 48,000 hertz. But that is the standard for digital audio. Not digital audio, but that's the standard for audio in film or other media audio. So I find this really fascinating, but it's probably just because I'm kind of a big geek about this stuff. But 24 frames per second, that is the amount of information that our eyes need to piece together a coherent visual. Meanwhile, our ears need 48,000 pieces of information every second in order to piece together the audio waveform and get a coherent audio waveform. So, I don't know. That's neither here nor there, but pretty interesting, I think. But we'll need to remember both of those things later on when we bring the film into our software program, our music software program. So, great. Let's go back to Keynote. And let's talk about spotting. Spotting is a conversation with the film director on where the music should and should not be, both equally important, and how music should function in different scenes. And when you're having a spotting conversation, you take notes. And your notes include SMPTE time code for music start for every single cue. Whenever there's going to be a new piece of music, you jot down where that music is going to start. You jot down any music transitions that are going to happen within the scene. And actually, at this point in the conversation, you wouldn't even refer to that as music transitions. You would refer to that with the director as just like basically moments that that need attention drawn to them through the music, or moments that the music should comment on. And then you, as the composer, later get to figure out if you really want the music to transition, or maybe you just line it up so there's like a downbeat at that moment. Or perhaps you do something where there's music and then the music goes to silence in a specific moment to draw attention to it. That can be really effective, especially in horror films. And then lastly, you'll want to jot down a spotting time for the music out point. Now, very important here, the music out point is not where you go and put your last chord. The music out point, the music needs to be totally free and clear by then, so you want to give yourself some time for your music to decay away. So you as a composer need to think about where the last note should go in order to have enough time for the music to totally decay out before the music out point. As a composer, the best thing you can do is to be decisive. This is probably the best information I got from my film scoring mentors over the years. You can really help yourself out if you don't agonize over every single little detail. Now, it takes some practice and it takes some time to really be able to have the confidence and to trust yourself in this realm. But if you're not agonizing over the dominant seventh chord being in first inversion or second inversion, then you know you can work faster and you can compose without pulling your hair out. Which is good because composers are supposed to have wild hair, so you don't want to pull all your hair out. And you'll just be a happier human being if you just make decisions and move on. So with that in mind, we are going to make decisions as composers for this short clip. Now, this clip could be scored several different ways, and really any two composers would probably score it totally differently. We could do an electronic sort of glitched out drum kind of a thing, and that would be really effective and really cool. We could also take kind of a more cinematic approach, and we could score it with a full orchestra and have some like rhythmic driving strings and some heavy orchestral percussion and some like crazy horn melody. What I have decided to do for this scene is to score it with a rock group. So we're going to do electric guitar, bass, and drums. And the feel or groove of the music is going to be jazzy, bluesy, but still electric guitar, so it's going to be kind of gritty, sort of like a rock, bluesy kind of a thing. And it's going to have an up-tempo feel around 125 beats per minute in 4/4 time. The music's going to come in right after the female cop says, give him a minute, then we'll hit it. And right after she says that, there's a cut to Callie. I want the music to start right on that cut. the way the music's going to function, it's going to support the on-screen action, and it's going to build tension within the scene. The music's going to transition when the cop says, police with a warrant, open up. I want the music to breathe a little bit. For one thing, that's a pretty major dialogue line, so we don't want to just bulldoze over it with music. It's also sort of a moment where we, as the viewers, are going to wonder what's going to happen. Is he actually going to come to the door and let them in, or are they going to have to pound the door down? So having the music breathe there, I think, will add a little bit of suspense to that moment in the scene. So what I'm going to do is have the music go to a downbeat, and it's going to play and hit a downbeat right on the cut to that cop right before he delivers that line. And it's just going to kind of hang there for a minute. And then the music's going to come back in when we see Callie fleeing out the back door. Now, there's a couple places where we could bring the music back in. We can bring it back in right on that cut to the rear entrance of the house. We could bring it back in as he jumps over the rail. What I want to do is bring the music fully back in when he lands on the ground, because that's really, to me, kind of the moment when the chase starts. So what I want to do actually is have a downbeat of music hit when Callie hits the ground, but I'm going to have a drum fill for a couple of beats into that. So he's going to jump over the rail. As he's hanging in the air, the drums are going to come in for a couple of beats, just do like a little fill, and then hit right when he hits the ground, and then the music's going to start up again. And the music's going to be a little bit faster there and a little bit more driving because the scene has evolved. And then the music out point, for this particular scene, it's an abbreviated scene and it fades to black, and so there's no defined out point. But if we were scoring an entire scene or an entire film, the music out point is a very important consideration. So, but it doesn't affect us right now with this scene. Okay, we're going to watch this one more time before we score it, and I want you to now think about all those things, where the music's going to come in on that cut and how it's going to pause on the cut right before the cop banging down the door, and then how it's going to come back in when Callie hits the ground and takes off running.
We've got a visual on a suspect approaching the house.
Okay, we'll give him a minute, then we'll hit it.
Over.
Alright, here is what the spotting notes look like for this scene. We've got the music end moment at 1 hour, 1 minute, 42 seconds, 19 frames, and in the notes there I have cut MS Cali. So what that means is, cut means it's a hard cut from one scene to another. So on one frame of film, it's the woman in the van, and then it cuts immediately to Cali on the very next scene. Some other different types of film editing transitions. It could be a dissolve. It could be a wipe, like you see in Star Wars. But this is a cut. And music transition at 1 hour, 2 minutes, 11 seconds, 5 frames. We cut to a... Oh, I didn't specify MS. MS is mid-shot. And mid-shot just means like torso up. If we were pulled back a little bit and we could see the entire person from head to toe, that'd be a full shot. If we're in closer on their face, that's a close-up. So anyway, cut to a mid-shot of the cop, and then the music transitions at 1 hour, 2 minutes, 15 seconds, 11 frames, when Callie lands on the ground and takes off. Now, just one quick thing about jotting down your SMPTE times. It's really hard to just get those on the fly, so what you can do in QuickTime is you play the movie and get close. So I'm watching for that cut, and I'm going to stop as close to that cut as I can.
Got a visual on a suspect approaching the house.
Okay, we'll give him a minute, then we'll hit it.
Over.
Okay. And then I hit the left arrows to back up, and I can kind of scrub back and forth with the right and left arrows. So here's the cut at 18 frames. It's on the cops in the van, and at 19 frames, it's on Callie. So 1 hour, 1 minute, 42 seconds, 19 frames. That's what I wrote down right here, or typed in, rather. Okay, cool. Now what we're going to do is we're going to perform a tempo calculation in a moment. We're going to kind of do it the old school way. Now you can do this in your music software, which you should do because it's kind of annoying to do the old school way, but I want you guys to see what goes on behind it because I think it's a really important thing to know as a film composer. Before we do that, just a couple of things. Different compositional approaches. Now, different composers will write music in totally different ways. And to me, from the way that I work and from the composers that I know, there's kind of three main categories. There's the old school composer. And these are the composers that jot down things on pencil and paper. And when they write a note down, they can hear it in their head. And God bless those guys because that is not an easy thing to do. There's the noodler category. I find myself to fit more in the noodler category. And what I like to do when I get a project is open up the film and bring up a piano sound and not even have a click track or anything, just like watch the film and play some initial raw ideas. You only have one opportunity to see the film with fresh eyes for the first time. So that's a really powerful thing. So to do this initial raw thing before I've seen the movie 10,000 times, I find to be really beneficial. Now, I may or may not end up using any of that material, but it's helpful nonetheless. A famous composer that fits into this category is Danny Elfman. I've read that he's chained to his MIDI keyboard. He can't do anything without actually physically playing the keys on the keyboard. He's definitely not one of those old school composer types. And then there's the concrete sequencer. And these are the composers that like to bring the film immediately into the software, start calculating tempos, start bringing up virtual instruments, start sequencing, and just going. And I certainly have approached projects that way in the past. And there's no one way that's better than the other. It's just kind of three different compositional approaches. The most important tool of the film scoring trade, now this is of course assuming that you already have honed in your composition skills, but the most important tool is that film composers know how to calculate tempo. Any composer knows allegro, moderato, presto, and fast and slow and all that stuff. But a film composer can write a piece of music that fits exactly in 32.4 seconds, and at 12.6 seconds, the bad guy pulls out the gun and the door slams and, you know, the music transitions there. So, like I was saying earlier, we are going to do a tempo calculation, and what we are calculating is beats per minute. Tempo is a ratio of beats per minute. That's not news to anybody. BPM. And what we need to determine is how much music, or more appropriately, how many beats are going to occur and how much elapsed time. So just to illustrate what can go wrong if you don't have proper syncing, here's a little video. This is illustrating the importance of proper syncing.
Das hier ist mein Sektor.
Das hier ist das wichtigste Gerät des Küstenwächters.
Das Gerät.
Überlebensradar.
Mayday, Mayday. Hello, can you hear us? Can you hear us? Can you... Okay, over. We are sinking.
Hello? This is the German Coast Guard.
We're sinking.
What are you thinking about?
All right, just a little joke. Maybe some of you guys have seen that commercial. I think it's hilarious, so I had to throw it in there. Different kind of syncing, of course. Okay, so back to our spotting notes. We've got music in at 42 seconds, 19 frames, and music transition at 11 seconds, 5 frames. So to do a tempo calculation, what we're going to do is take the music transition time, and we're going to subtract the start time to figure out the amount of elapsed time between these two SMPTE times. Now, doing this kind of a calculation is like a major headache. So again, it's important to know this stuff. I'm going to show you guys how to do it, but then we're going to also do it in our music software later. The reason why this is so painful is because none of those numbers fit really nicely into increments of 100. We have 24 frames per second. We have 60 seconds per minute. We have 60 minutes per hour. So first what we need to do is figure out the difference in frames. So the way that I like to think about this is that in the top number, we are 5 frames past the 11th second. So set that aside. We've got 5 frames. In the bottom number, we have 5 frames to go to get to the 43rd second because we're at 24 frames per second. 24 minus 19 is 5. So the difference between those is 10 frames. And then we'll do the same thing to figure out the difference in seconds. In the top number, we're 11 seconds past the second minute. In the bottom number, we've already accounted for those 5 frames. So think about it from the 43rd second. We have 17 seconds to go from the 43rd second to get to the 2-minute mark. So 11 plus 17 is 28. So the elapsed time between these is 28 seconds, 10 frames. Now that is not 28.1 seconds. What we need to do is figure out how much time 10 frames takes. So to do that, we divide 24 into 10, and we get 0.4. So 28.4 seconds is our elapsed time. Hang with me. We're almost done here. We're going to take 15 measures. Now, you guys as composers get to decide the amount of music you want to try to fit in a certain amount of time. I think you'll find that it's really a trial and error process. I find that it's really good to have a target tempo in mind, and I've already said I want the target tempo to be 125 beats per minute. And so what you'll do is you'll do a tempo calculation. Maybe you'll say 15 measures and find that that gives you a tempo of around 140, so that's too fast. So you need to slow the tempo down by having less music occur in that elapsed time. So you do a calculation with 14 measures and so on until you get a tempo that works, and then you know how much music you need to write in that moment, in that time. This is another skill that film composers have, to be able to write odd number of measures phrasing. As a composer, as a film composer, you can't do 8 bars of verse, 8 bars of chorus. You'll have to write music that fits into maybe like 7 bars and 2 beats. And to do that, you like sneak in a bar of 2/4 somewhere to try to, you know, and you got to do it so that it makes sense musically. So at any rate, 15 measures at 4/4 time gives us 60 beats of music. That math is thankfully much easier. So we have 4 beats per measure times 15 measures, 60 beats of music. So our tempo is 60 beats in 28.4 seconds. Now that actually is a tempo ratio, but what we need is beats per minute, not beats per 28.4 seconds. So the last thing we need to do is convert this fraction so that it's beats per minute. Now, I don't know if you guys remember much about fractional multiplication from your algebra classes, but we can do this function right now because that number on the right is 1. Anything over itself is 1, and if you multiply something by 1, it doesn't change the number. What it will do is convert the bottom number, 28.4 times 2.11268 gives us 60. And so the top number there, 60 beats times that number, is whatever our new tempo is. which happens to be 126.7606 beats per 60 seconds, or 126.7606 beats per minute, or BPM. That is a completely crazy tempo that only a film composer would need. If you're recording a band in the studio, you set the metronome to 127 and you call it good. But a film composer needs to be exact, often to the fourth decimal place, in order to be totally perfect and right on. So anyway, I hope you guys don't have a headache. This is a very important exercise to be able to do as a film composer. And now we're going to test it out and see how close we were. So what I want to do is switch over to Logic. Now, there's a lot of music applications that you can use for film scoring. I'm using Logic today in this webinar, but there's, you know, many different options out there on PC and Mac. And any of those applications that have video syncing ability and SMPTE abilities will probably have some kind of a tempo calculator built in. So first thing I want to do is add markers at these moments here that we've spotted out. So actually, one thing I need to do even before that is get the film and Logic properly synced up. So if you notice, the film is loaded up. I can hit play. And it's synced. It's going in the sense that I hit play in Logic, and Logic starts, and the movie starts. But if you notice the time code right here in Logic, it does not agree with the time code in the film. So there's a couple things we need to do. The first thing we want to do is to tell Logic that this film is at 24 frames per second. And we do that in Project Settings, Synchronization, right here, Frame Rate, 24 frames per second. Next thing we need to do, if you guys remember when we looked at the movie in QuickTime, we determined that the audio was at 48 kilohertz for the sample rate. So we can set that here, 48 kilohertz for the audio sample rate. We need to set both of those things. Now the next thing we need to do is tell Logic where this film starts, because this film does not start at 0 hours, 0 minutes, 0 seconds, 0 frames. I've pulled this clip out of the middle of the movie. So it starts at 1 hour, 1 minute, 37 seconds, 17 frames. You want to go to the very first frame of film, and then you go to the movie sync settings, and you put in the movie start time like that, so that those things agree. Now what I've essentially done is taken the film and I've moved it forward a minute, 37 seconds, and 17 frames. Logic before was having the movie start at 1 hour, 0:00, and now I've moved the film a minute and 37 seconds, 17 frames forward. So it doesn't even come in until like after bar 49. You can see I can play here. And once it hits this moment, it starts up. And now the film and Logic are pretty well synced. Occasionally you'll notice there's a frame of drift. And that can be kind of annoying, but basically Logic does the best that it can. What you want to test is just insert the play cursor somewhere near the end of the movie. And if it syncs up, you're good to go. Now the thing about it is this time code is not digitally embedded in the film. It's just a visual display. So occasionally Logic will have moved to the next SMPTE frame, but the movie is still like lagging behind by possibly even just milliseconds. So if you put the cursor somewhere near the end of the movie and you're right there, or you're just even just one frame off, don't worry about it. It's synced. You're good to go. And as I'm moving around here, you can see that like if I just kind of drop it in random places, I'm at 18 seconds, 0 frames, 18 seconds, 0 frames. Let's move somewhere else. 23 seconds, 12 frames, 23 seconds, 12 frames. So we are synced. We're good to go. Now, there's all this empty space at the beginning. So the next thing I need to do is put in my... I've set the movie start time. I now need to put in the music start time. And so back to our spotting notes. Music starts at 1 minute 42 seconds, 19 frames. So I go into synchronization where we set the frame rate. This is also where we go to put in the music start time. We can say that bar 1 plays its empty time code. I already forgot it. 1 minute 42 seconds, 19 frames. Boom. So now I've moved the film. Actually, I've moved logic bar 1 forward by 1 minute 42 seconds and 18 frames. And now bar 1 occurs right at that scene cut to Callie, just like we wanted it to. Okay, great. Now I'm going to go in and put in some markers. Anywhere you need to accent the film with the music, basically anything that you've taken notes on in the spotting discussion, you want to put in a marker for. So in the marker window here, I can add a new marker. You want to lock that puppy so that you can change the tempo and that marker will stay synced to the film to real time. That's what locking it does. You can see that little padlock there. And it really helps to name these, especially if you have like 50 markers in the scene. So music in. Now our next marker occurs at 2 minutes, 11 seconds, 5 frames, which is on the cut to that cop. Actually, I wrote it down wrong in the spotting notes, which means we calculated it to the wrong frame. But I'm going to put the marker here, 2 minutes, 11 seconds, 5 frames. That cut actually happens here at 2 minutes, 11 seconds, 4 frames. And I've got it listed here at 5 frames. Anyway, we're going to put the marker at 5 frames. That goes by so fast that visually you're not even gonna notice. When you hear the music, it will sound like it syncs up to that scene. If you're within 2 or 3 frames, your eyes and ears will just see it as happening at the same time. Much more than that, and you'll probably notice a bit of a delay. So this is cut to mid-shot of the cop. Okay. And then lastly, 2 minutes, 15 seconds, 11 frames is where Callie... Hey, look at that. I stopped it within one frame. It's like pumping gas and stopping it at 99 cents. Okay. There we go. And so this isn't a scene cut, so this is a little harder to judge. But there he is hanging in there. All right. And then he lands... 11 frames, 12 frames, right in there. But I said that it was at 11 frames. So we're going to put in another marker. And this is Callie lands. And I got to lock these. Okay, cool. So if we calculated our tempo correctly, we should be able to put that tempo in and have this moment in the film fall exactly on the downbeat of bar 16. We calculated it out so that 15 measures of music could happen in that span of time. So it should fall at the end of the 15th measure, effectively the downbeat of bar 16. So the tempo that we calculated out, 126.7606. Let's put that in. Okay. And let's do a test. Okay, I'm going to zoom way in, and here is the downbeat of bar 16, and here is our marker. Now, I'm zoomed in so far that if I move by one frame, that's how much it moves. So we are within one frame. So that's pretty good. Now we could have had logic calculate out that tempo for us, and let's see if logic comes up with a similar number. So we open up the tempo operations window, which is really just a glorified calculator. And we say we outline our position, starting at bar 1, ending at bar 16. We want to calculate the tempo for... we want the tempo to get us to this moment at bar 16, and it'll spit out a number here. So 1 hour, 2 minutes, 11 seconds, 5 frames. That actually is our number. So logic gives us the exact same number that we came up with. So that's awesome. Now what that means is that we are really less than a frame off. That is as close as logic can get us to that moment, which is close enough. Close enough for horseshoes and hand grenades and film scoring. Okay. Cool. Now let me put the metronome on and let's check it out. Cut. Okay, cool. That worked. Great. Now we want to calculate out tempo so that where Cali lands falls on a downbeat. Now as I zoom in here, you can see that is really close to measure 18, beat 2. So there's a couple things that I could do. I could have the tempo change at bar 16, and I could either make the tempo slower so that less music elapses in that amount of time, and we move that moment, we move bar 18 to that moment in the film. Or we speed the music up, allowing for more music to happen, and we move bar 19 to that moment in the film. I actually don't want to do either of those things. This is really close to beat 2, so what I'm going to do instead is change measure 17 to a bar of 5/4, and then I'm going to change measure 18 back to 4/4, and now that falls really close to the downbeat of bar 18, so that's kind of a sneaky thing that you need to be able to do as a film composer. Great. So now I'm going to calculate out a tempo because we want it to be exact. And I'm going to have this start at bar 16 and go to bar 18. And now this tells me where bar 18 currently is. It's at 2 minutes, 15 seconds, 11 frames. Actually, that is right on the money. We don't even really need to change the tempo at all. That's cool. So if I zoom way in, yeah, we are within a frame. So that's good. Again, that's as close as logic can get us, which is close enough. Great. So we've got our scene, we've got our tempos, our markers in there. Now I had wanted the music to speed up here. So I'm going to grab the pencil tool and draw in a tempo change. Let's speed it up to like 132. That'll be cool. So we go from around 127 to around 132. So it's a little faster, a little more urgent. The chase is on. The scene has evolved, so it kind of necessitates a change in music. So I have pre-scored this. This is actually the score that I wrote for the actual scene. So let me play for you the music that I wrote. And again, I was going to do drums, guitar, and bass. And so that's what I did here. I have two guitar parts. There's a guitar melody and a guitar harmonics on a delay here. And what I want you to pay attention to is in the beginning of the scene where the police are surrounding the house, but Cali doesn't know they're there yet, the music is... it's building, it's adding tension. You can see it's building in the sense that I'm adding instruments. I've kind of stacked instruments in here. But the music isn't really in any particular hurry yet. It's kind of just wandering, sort of waiting to see what's going to happen. And then after this moment where the music drops out, when it comes back in, it's a lot more urgent and a lot more driving, and everything is playing together. So let's watch this through with the music.
Give him a minute.
Let me turn the metronome off. Okay, I'm going to give us a 2 bar pre-roll here.
Okay, we'll give him a minute, then we'll hit it. Okay, great. There you have it. That was the Art of Film Scoring, How to Score a Scene. Thank you guys very much for being here tonight. I've really had a lot of fun putting this on. You know, when I put this out there, I wasn't totally sure what kind of a response I would get, and I've been pleasantly surprised. There were a lot of people that signed up for this, and tonight in this webinar, there's people from all over the world. There's people from the UK, from Australia, from Israel, from Johannesburg, from Athens, from Budapest, and there are 16 states of the U.S. represented. So lots of people here. So that, you know, that tells me that there's a real hunger for film scoring resources online. So with that in mind, that's really why I started up Siebel Studios, and we are just getting started. We've got a lot of stuff coming up. We're going to do some webinars on game scoring, on sound design, on recording specific instruments, and we have three courses going on starting next month. Two are on technical aspects of film scoring, one in Digital Performer, one in Logic. Those classes are 2 weeks each. They're $49. And then we have our flagship class, which is called The Art of Film Scoring. Let me pull that up here. And it's a 6-week class starting October 2nd. And we'll be talking about film music history, thematic analysis, music theory and composition techniques, technical aspects of film scoring, self-promotion tips for film composers. By the end of that course, you will have scored 2 demo pieces. I'm very pleased to offer you guys a 30% discount with the promo code here as a thank you for attending this webinar. So the promo code there is SeaWolfOnline, all lowercase, all one word, and you can register for this class at seawolfstudios.net. If you guys are thinking you might want to take this class, I would suggest to sign up sooner rather than later. I like to keep these classes small and intimate, so spots are limited. Register now, and I hope to see you guys in the class. This really is a lot of fun for me, and I really want to hear the music that you write. The thing that's cool about the class setting is it's online, so you can study anywhere in the world, but you still get the benefit of being in a class with people. So you'll be critiquing each other's music. You'll get feedback on your music from me, too, and from your peers, which will really help you grow as a composer. So anyway, check it out. Thank you for your time. Hope you guys had fun. I certainly did. And take care. Have a great night.